He's the same. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to St. John's Eden Church Online for our service of evening praise. Hasn't it been a beautiful day? And it still is. It still looks like it's going to be a lovely, lovely evening. So great that you could join us today. If you are watching us, please do post a comment in the Facebook thread at the bottom so that we know you're there. So let me just name a few people. Mark has just joined us. He says hello, good to have you with us, Mark. Dawn is here too. She says good evening, everyone. And Carolyn and Moira and Sarah, great that you are here with us. If you are watching and I've not mentioned your name, please just post a comment and we can include you then in our conversations and our prayers. But great to be together. This is our third service today. We had a baptism service at 11 o'clock this morning in church with a family all the way from Florida, which is a long way to come, isn't it, for a baptism service. But they have a sort of historic links with Yorkshire, and they've been across for a few weeks, and we baptised one of their children this morning, and that was great. Well, good for us to be together. Let me share with you some of the things that are happening in the church that you might be interested in. So I'll just put the notices on the screen. Okay, so this week our Chatty Cafe is running. This runs monthly on Wednesdays. Wednesday the 13th of July. It's just a lovely occasion. We get the tablecloths out and the posh china, and we have tea and coffee and cakes and savouries, and then usually a speaker. And on this occasion, the Yorkshire Air Ambulance are flying in. Well, probably not literally. It'd be most exciting if they came in a helicopter and landed in the church grounds. But anyway, somebody's coming from the Yorkshire Air Ambulance to speak about their important work. So do join us for that on Wednesday at 1:30 if you're able to. Now, each week we also have a drop-in cafe, which is on Thursday mornings, and people come from church and from the local community just to chat, have a cup of coffee, maybe play some games together, and just to build some relationships. You'd be most welcome to join us for that. Now, for those of you with children or grandchildren, why not come along to our community cinema event, which is next Saturday. Again, these things happen about once a month. Saturday the 16th of July at 5:30, we're showing the recently released DVD, Encanto, that latest Disney film. It's free. Sometimes parents really struggle to take the children to the big cinema in Leeds because it's so flipping expensive, especially once you add snacks and that's all that kind of thing. So come along for free with your children and grandchildren next Saturday. And then the last notice is for those who are members of St John's. We're having a bring and share lunch after the second service next Sunday. Sunday the 17th of July, around about 12:15, 12:30, depending what time we finish the service. If you're going to come, please do let us know, and also let us know what food that you're bringing, and we'll perhaps be able to guide you a little bit in that so that we have a nice balance of sweets and savouries. But do come along for a great time of fellowship. Hopefully, if the weather's going to be as it is today, then we can sit out as well. I'll even put the marquee out and make everything really, really lovely. So do join us for what will be perhaps the last opportunity before the school summer shutdown. Everybody starts going off for holidays and so on. So that's next week, next Sunday. All right, I think that brings us to the start of our service. Let me just see if anybody else has joined us. Okay, Pat, you're here as well. Good to have you with us. And Jude is here as well. Have you recovered from yesterday? I hope you had a great time. It seems like you did. Jude and Steve celebrated their 10th wedding anniversary yesterday at church, and we had a great service, and then there were lots of things going on afterwards as well. So great that you could join us tonight. All right. Can we just take a moment to be quiet, and then we'll use the words on the screen to begin our worship. Arise, shine, for your light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us. God in Christ has revealed his glory. Come, let us worship. Give him praise, you servants of the Lord. Oh, praise the name of the Lord. And that's what we're going to do now. We're going to praise the name of our God. We're going to sing a couple of songs of worship. And our group and from church and from elsewhere are going to help us to do that.
Wonder.
Isn't that a wonderful truth? We are children of God through our faith in Jesus Christ. And there, we're there in the Father's house, enjoying fellowship with him as we gather together tonight. Of course, we are sinners too, in need of his grace. And these words on the screen gives the opportunity to turn once more and to receive the Lord's forgiveness afresh. The gospel calls us to turn away from sin and be faithful to Christ. As we offer ourselves to God in penitence and faith, we renew our trust in his mercy. So let's take a moment to be quiet and ask God by his Spirit to show us those things that we need to confess to him tonight. If you'd like to join in with the words in yellow. We have not always worshipped God, our Creator. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We have not always followed Christ, our Saviour. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. We have not always trusted in the Spirit, our guide. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. So may the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. So we now come to our time of Bible reading. We're going to have two readings, both from the New Testament. Firstly, a reading from Colossians chapter 1. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to God's holy people in Colossae, the faithful brothers and sisters in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love you have for all God's people, the faith and love that spring from the hope stored up for you in heaven and about which you have already heard in the true message of the gospel that has come to you. In the same way, the gospel is bearing fruit and growing throughout the whole world, just as it has been doing among you since the day you heard it and truly understood God's grace. You learned it from Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf, and who also told us of your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge of his will, through all the wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in every good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and patience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father, who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading is from Luke's Gospel, a very familiar passage, Luke chapter 10, verses 25 to 37. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" he replied. "How do you read it?" He answered, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbour as yourself." "You have answered correctly," Jesus replied. "Do this, and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbour?" In reply, Jesus said, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he travelled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. 'Look after him,' he said, 'and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbour to the man who fell into the hands of robbers?" The expert in the law replied, "The one who had mercy on him." And Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, I'm going to be thinking a little bit more about that reading in just a few moments. But before we get into all that, we're going to worship again. And we're going to sing that classic Graham Kendrick song, "Knowing You, Jesus, All I Once Held Dear."
Oh, Well, what an interesting week it has been for us nationally and politically in our country. We have a Prime Minister who believes he is qualified to lead our country because he was voted in by an overwhelming majority of the people. And we have a parliamentary system where most other members believe he has disqualified himself by virtue of his personal decisions and duplicitous behaviour. So is he qualified or is he not qualified? I want us today to think about that word qualified. In today's gospel reading, somebody asked Jesus, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" In other words, how can I qualify to be part of the new heaven on earth that God is bringing into the world, Jesus? Now, it seems to me that that's a very, very important question to know the answer to, because Jesus tells us that this present life is not all that there is. And if that is true, then we need to know how we can be part of this new age, this new realm, this new kind of life that God is bringing. Otherwise, we might find ourselves booted out of the house, as it were, lost for all eternity, disqualified from eternal life. What does Jesus say? Well, he seems to set an impossibly high standard. So Jesus answers his questioner with a question. He says, "What does the Bible say?" And he directs him to the law of Moses and to the other Jewish scriptures, because in them God has spoken his truth and revealed his nature. And actually, in passing, I might say that what does the Bible say is a good place for us to start too, in our search for purpose and truth for our lives. So the man who comes to Jesus answers with an excellent summary of the whole law, a summary that Jesus himself gave on another occasion. He says this: "Love God with 100% of your life, with every fiber of your being, all your heart and your soul and your mind and your strength. And love everybody else just as you love yourself." And Jesus says, "Brilliant answer. Do all of that and you will qualify for eternal life." As it says in the famous Meerkat adverts, "Simples." Simple, that is, until you think more deeply about the implications. To love God 100% and your neighbour as yourself is a standard that is way beyond what our human nature, with all its selfishness and sinfulness, can deliver. It's like somebody with broken legs asking, "How high do I have to jump in order to qualify for the Olympics?" Well, even 1 meter is going to be too high an answer. Or it's like somebody without an education asking what the pass mark is in a physics A-level exam so they can qualify for university. Even 50% would be too hard for them. So 100% would be impossible. Jesus's answer confronts us actually with our hopeless situation. But only if we see it. And very often we don't. What we do instead is reduce God's requirements to something we feel is more manageable. So if people ask us, "How does Jesus expect us to live in order to go to heaven?" we answer in essence, "Oh, it's not too difficult. Just pray to God and try to be a nice person." See what we do? We set the bar really low. And that's what the person does who comes to Jesus in this passage. He says, "Well, who is my neighbour?" And he's hoping for an answer that isn't too difficult to do. It won't involve loving the Romans, won't involve loving Samaritans and other people that we don't like. But Jesus sets the bar very high. He says, "Absolutely anybody who is in need is your neighbour." So once again, we are confronted with the truth of what God requires of us, and we're unable to do it Not because God's standards are unreasonable, but because we human beings have become something very different to what God intended. You see, God made us to live in perfect holiness and faithfulness to him, enjoying his love and fully expressing that love into the world. That was his design for us. But instead, we have become sinful, fallen, selfish, and broken. And so we can't live as God planned. It's simply impossible for us to live this way. So the first stage in qualifying for eternal life, therefore, is to recognize that you can't get there by yourself. God's qualifying standards are wonderful, but they're simply beyond us. Well, praise God. Jesus provides us with an alternative way to qualify. Jesus sends his questioner in the crowd away to think a bit more deeply about God's qualifying standards for eternal life. He doesn't, at that stage, give him a complete answer. And Jesus often did that with people. But on other occasions, Jesus spoke of an alternative way of qualifying for God's kingdom. And that is by coming back to God and asking for his forgiveness for all our sins and failings. And this is what Jesus provides for us, the opportunity to do that. In another of Jesus' stories, he tells of a son who disrespects his father and goes off to a foreign land and wastes all his dad has given him in sinful living. But when that son realizes what he's done, he comes back home and he's broken-hearted and repentant, and his father forgives him and restores him back into the family. You'll find this in Luke chapter 15, in what we call the parable of the prodigal son. The son qualifies for his place back in the family, not because he deserves it, not because he's lived with 100% perfection, but because his father is loving and kind, and he, the son, is willing to humbly ask for forgiveness and to begin a new kind of life. Now, we've been living through a time of scandal and accusation and resignations in our current UK government, haven't we? 50 years ago in the United States, there was a far more serious period of criminal government activity known as the Watergate scandal. Some of you might be old enough to remember that time. It resulted in the resignation of the then president, Richard Nixon. A number of government officials were actually convicted of crimes and sent to prison as a result. And one of them was a man called Charles Colson. Colson was one of President Nixon's closest confidants at the time, and the realization of how his own self-centeredness and pride had led him astray so badly, that actually brought him to faith in Jesus Christ. And Colson writes in his book, Born Again, "Suddenly I felt naked and unclean. My bravado, defences gone. I saw myself as I never had before, and the picture was ugly." And he allowed a Christian friend to pray with him, and then Colson sat alone in his car, and there he prayed what he called the first real prayer of his life. He prayed this: "God, I don't know how to find you, but I'm going to try. I'm not much the way I am now, but somehow I want to give myself to you." And within a few days, he had become a real, committed, repentant and forgiven, born again Christian. And that's what we all need to do too, if we haven't already done so. Jesus provides us with an alternative way to qualify for eternal life, and we must take hold of it. In our other Bible passage today, what Jesus has done for us is described like this. The Father has qualified you. There's that word, qualified. The Father has qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light. For, so this is how he's done it, he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. That's Colossians chapter 1. What is impossible for us to do by ourselves is made possible for us by Jesus. Because he died and rose again, forgiveness is freely available to us. And we need to take hold of that forgiveness by believing in what God has done for us through Jesus and sincerely asking God for his forgiveness. I've got one more thing to say. That is this. Jesus still expects us, however, to learn to live in love. Loving God and loving others is still how Jesus tells us to live. We don't do this in order to qualify for eternal life because we can't do it well enough to reach God's standard. But once we accept the forgiveness that God provides through Jesus, once we know that this qualifies us to be in his family, then we begin the journey of slowly learning to do, bit by bit, what God wants us to do. If you are a true Christian, then this is the journey that you are on. Learning to love God with every fibre of your being, heart, soul, mind, strength, and learning to love everyone, without exception, in the same way that you love yourself. And you cannot do the second, by the way, if you do not do the first. It's only when we come to an end of ourselves and find ourselves in God and God in us that we gain the power to forget ourselves and to live in love for others. Let me finish with a wonderful example of somebody who did that so well. Mother Teresa, who for much of her life lived among the poor and served the poor, was also a deeply prayerful and God-centered person. And that's what gave her the strength to live in that way. And she said this: spend 1 hour each day in adoration of your Lord. There it is, God at the centre. And never do anything you know is wrong. Follow this and you'll be fine. Spread love everywhere you go. Let no one ever come to you without leaving happier. May God break my heart so completely that the whole world falls in. What a wonderful way of expressing it. And of course, this is still a challenge. But if we come to Jesus, God gives us his Holy Spirit to live inside us and to change us. And bit by bit, we get a little better at it. Day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year. Through Jesus' life, death and resurrection, God has qualified you to inherit eternal life. Believe it, receive it, and proclaim it with all your heart. And then love God with everything you've got and everyone else just as you love yourself. Doing that won't qualify you for eternal life because you can't fully do it. But once you have eternal life through Jesus, then it's the way he wants you to live. And let's face it, it's a wonderful way to live. Shall we pray?
Indeed, shall we pray? I want to give those watching this now, or perhaps we'll watch it later, an opportunity. If you've never in your life come to God and asked him wholeheartedly to forgive you, and then turned to God and put your trust in Jesus to save you, then I'd like to give you the opportunity to do that right now. Those of you who have already done it, perhaps you'd like to pray for everybody else as we pray. So close your eyes, and if you tonight want to come back to God and receive his forgiveness and that gift of eternal life, then just pray this prayer with me now. Pray it slowly, line by line, and you repeat it between you and God, wherever you are right now. Say it from your heart to him. Dear Heavenly Father, I am sorry for all the times that I have ignored you. I am sorry for when I've gone my own way in life instead of your way. I have not loved you 100%. And I have not loved my neighbour as myself. And I need, God, your forgiveness. Dear God, I thank you for sending Jesus into this world to die on that cross so that I could be forgiven and then to rise from the dead so that I could have a brand new life. I believe in this and I believe in him. And tonight, Lord, I give my life back to you. Please forgive me for all of my sins. And please give me that gift of eternal life made available through your Son, Jesus. I welcome you into my life by your Holy Spirit. Come and be my Saviour, my friend, and my Lord. Dear God, I will follow you with the help of your Holy Spirit for the rest of my days on earth. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer for the first time, or perhaps you prayed it as a prayer of recommitment, then I want you to know that God's presence is working in your life right now in a new way. And you've begun the most wonderful journey there is in life. A journey with Jesus, a journey with God, your Father. And you've already received his forgiveness and his gift of eternal life. You've got wonderful things ahead of you. If that's you, it's really important that you let other people know. So you might like to just post something in the Facebook thread to say that you prayed that prayer tonight. Or if you prefer, then contact me privately afterwards. My details are widely available. You can find me on Messenger. You can send me an email. You can ring me. All the details are on our church Facebook page. And I'll be happy to spend a bit of time encouraging you as you begin your journey with Jesus. Now let's pray for our world and for those in need. Dear Lord, we pray for our broken, messed up world. Continue to pray, Lord, for peace in Ukraine. But Lord, we also pray for that situation of conflict in Sri Lanka. We pray for people in Japan following that assassination of the former president. We pray for all places round our world where there is conflict. And God, we pray that your kingdom will invade with its justice and peace and love. We pray that you'll strengthen our brothers and sisters in those places, that they might represent you well, speaking of your love and showing your love in practical ways. Lord, we pray for our own nation, the UK, during this time in which we are looking for a new Prime Minister. God, we pray that your hand will be on all that takes place in these coming weeks. Lord, bless our government, bless the whole parliamentary system, that the decisions that they make may represent your kingdom, may be decisions of justice and peace and care, especially for those in need. We pray all of these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And shall we pray for those that we know who are ill at the moment or going through a hard time? You might just like to take a moment in the silence to say their names out loud where you are, and God will hear. And I'm going to, in a few moments, just mention some from our church fellowship who need a touch of the Lord's presence tonight. But let's be quiet together first of all. You pray your own prayers. Here are some from the fellowship here at St. John's Eden. So Lord, we pray for Janice and Mandy and Anita and Susan and David and Ray and David and Christina, Malcolm and Joyce, Diana, Andrea and Doreen. And Lord, for these people and for those we've mentioned who have been joining in with this service, Lord, we bring them into your presence and we ask that because of Jesus, because of his death and resurrection, your grace will pour upon them as well, meeting their needs, Lord, imparting your healing, bringing your strength and your peace and whatever they need. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you are a good and gracious God who delights to pour out your goodness upon us. And we pray for your goodness to touch each of those people. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And so gathering our prayers and our praises into one, as our Saviour has taught us, so together we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Okay, well, let's end our service as we finish the 11 o'clock service today, the greatest day in history. People were dancing almost in the aisles this morning and clapping and really singing this from their hearts. So let's do that here, wherever you are. Sing from your heart, maybe even get up out of your chair and dance around as we thank God for what he's done for us through Jesus. Thank you. Hallelujah. Well, I hope you've enjoyed being together tonight. Thank you so much for joining us. Please do post some closing comments and perhaps prayer requests before you go, and we can all pray for one another during this coming week. Let's finish with a blessing. You might like to close your eyes and just put your hands out in front of you to receive the presence of the Holy Spirit afresh with the Lord's blessing. God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be with you now, this day and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
The power.